this chair back here.
No. I'm just gonna do this and then I'll stand up and do the job.
So good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the Friday Lecture team, I'd like to thank everyone for coming. Today is the opening event of the Friday Lecture Series for 2014. The theme for the next 8 weeks will be Life After Studio. Life After Studio has many different meanings for people, but what we want to explore is the reality of leaving the architecture studio and moving into the profession, the architectural profession. So over the next 8 weeks, we will have a range of speakers giving lectures at the school, each covering how they dealt with that transition. They've also been asked to reflect on three main factors that we believe have influenced their careers as architects. These are their educational experiences, the economic climate that they work in, and the professional networks that they've built for themselves. We hope this lecture will provide some insights and guidance into our lives after studio. So today we start at the beginning with a debate on architectural education. Architectural education is being currently rethought in this country, primarily in terms of its relationship to practice and what is perceived as a disconnect between academic provision and professional needs. It is also being rethought in terms of its duration and the possible combination of years of study that are required to achieve qualification. Whilst these are undoubtedly relevant concerns, we fear vital aspects of this debate on education might be lost if it remains focused solely on these issues. So, is education the opportunity for us to equip ourselves with the skills we need to be more entrepreneurial, to be adaptable to the challenge of this current economic climate and a changing profession? Maybe we're looking at an architectural education that equips us to deal with architecture for the 99% rather than the 1%. So, and also in this current climate where 44% of unqualified graduates, which is us when we finish our fifth year, and 22% of qualified architects are unemployed, we think it's clear that us as graduates need to become more flexible in order to respond and survive. So that's our opening. I'd like to thank ADS, who are sponsoring the recording of this event. Their footage will be posted on the website for further and continued discussion. They see this as part of a bigger debate they're having at the moment on an exhibition called Reactivate. That's still on at the Lighthouse for the next 2 weeks. Just a note on this microphone, it doesn't amplify your voice, it just records. So speak up and speak into it. With that, I'd like to introduce Robert Mantho, who has kindly agreed to chair the debate today. Robert is the Stage 5 leader here at the Mackintosh School of Architecture and the founder of Locus, a collaborative practice. So, over to Robert. Thanks.
Hello, everybody. I just have been asked to make sure I explain the structure of the debate. What we've got is three questions, and so we'll be dealing with them in three sessions. Not every member of the panel will answer every question. I will read the question and ask the corresponding member of the panel to answer the question. Each member of the panel will have 5 minutes to discuss their response or to respond to the question, and then we'll open up the question to the floor for 15 minutes. I'd like to remind everybody that the microphone doesn't amplify your voice, so you need to speak up and make sure you speak into it carefully. I'd like to introduce the members of the panel. I'll start with Stuart Falconer, who is a young architect who graduated from Strathclyde in 2006. He received the RIAS Silver Medal Commendation as a student. He is a founder of Grass Studio with Gunnar Groves Rains, who's sitting right over here, in Edinburgh, formed in 2006 as part of the established conservation practice Groves Rains Architects Limited. Lucy Morey is an independent consultant for architects focusing on marketing, PR, and business development. Lucy specializes in helping architects to become more business-like. She is a contributor to the RIBA CPD training in marketing and business planning and lectures at the London Metropolitan University, London South Bank University, the Bartlett School of Architecture at the University of Central London, and the University of Cambridge. Professor Chris Platt is the head of the Mackintosh School of Architecture and founding director of award-winning architectural practice Studio CAP. Chris is a fellow of the Higher Education Academy and was made a fellow of the Royal Incorporation of Architects Scotland in 2009. He lectures widely and is an alumni of the MAC. Hanneke Scott Van Wel is the director of Stone Opera, focusing on improving relationships between people and their built environment through interactive and playful architectural workshops. She's an architect registered both in the Netherlands and in the UK, and is currently an architectural design tutor at Strathclyde University. David Goster has been the director of education at the Royal Institute of British Architects since 2006. Prior to his current position, he was a principal lecturer and postgraduate course leader at the Department of Architecture and Design at London South Bank University. David is responsible for a variety of programs that support architectural schools, students, and academics. He oversees the RIBA program of validation as well. Ian Scott is founder of award-winning business Cognitive Business Therapy, who are specialists in how people and organizations learn to be enterprising. He's an entrepreneur who helps people start their own businesses. Ian will provide a voice from outside of the discipline of architecture with an acute understanding of the challenges in today's commercial environment. So with those introductions, I'd like to ask the first question, which is, what is the purpose of architectural education today? What are we trying to achieve through that education? And the first person I'd like to answer that question is David Gloucester.
Thank you very much. I think the purpose of a long exposure to architecture education is actually that graduates come out of schools as versatile problem solvers who are able to survive in a variety of contexts, both in terms of the scale of enterprise that they work within, the geographical location they work within, and the nature of the problems which they're given to solve. And essentially, if you take design as being an holistic intellectual pursuit, which can involve seeing the design of a schedule for the delivery of a building to the design of a piece of ironmongery, then I think actually you're on the right track. What we need to do, I think, is to understand that this is a restless and curious profession, and it also has the capability to reinvent itself very, very quickly. This is probably a good thing, because capitalism, which we are essentially a servant of, is also an amazingly versatile and quick-witted beast, and the marketization, I think, of practice and the increasingly corporate nature of globalized practice is something which we may all have a view on, but which we actually have to learn to live with and actually also need to learn to thrive within. So the purpose of an education in architecture, I think certainly understanding what design in all its fullest ramifications means is critical to that. At the moment we have, of course, a structure which essentially has its provenance not even in the 1958 Oxford Conference on Architecture, but actually in the 1929 Congress on Architecture Education. So the roots of the current system go back a very long way, and the purpose of architecture education should be fitness for purpose, actually, and it's a question of defining what that purpose is. Every school, I think, has a very good crack at doing it in their own particular way, but we don't have robust structures necessarily that allow us to compare and contrast those very, very different strategies towards architecture education.
I'd next like to ask Chris Platt.
Okay, I want to read something just to sort of clarify a few of my own thoughts. I think contemporary practice is shifting further and further away from critical theory and academic preoccupations. And I think with the link between the academy and the profession is closer, the quality and the intelligence of the built environment and the discourse is generally higher, noticeably higher. I think the current student generation is more globally aware, more digitally switched on than any before it, and I think is interested in architecture as a social, cultural activity which makes people's lives better in a very fundamental way, be it here in the global north or somewhere else in the global south. I think profound need can sometimes be the catalyst for innovative thinking and a redefinition of professional roles. I think the way that architecture students learn in the studio is a school's unique selling point. And the lessons from the teaching ethos that comes from the studio is something that other university departments from other disciplines have long learned as innovative teaching. And in the MAC, we highly value this idea of the studio of both a way of working in a physical place. And for the digitally switched on generation with the world's libraries only a click away, there's always a question, why do you go to a physical place? And the studio, in my view, is the answer to that. So I believe that architecture education should be unapologetically vocational in its ethos, not for training purposes, and concerned with lifelong learning and the practice of the next generation of architects. Those who envisage an architectural destination and can articulate built form to bear the imprint of human life and feeling deserve the title architect, and those who have it or wish it are urgently required. So an architect's job, I think, is to create real quality where people come face to face with their built environment. And I think the purpose of architectural education is to inspire people to do that. Making, I think, is a privilege, and particularly in this mysterious digital age where we don't understand the tools we use and we throw them away and upgrade them as easy as we buy them. And so mastering them is never something that we do. So I want our agenda to redefine what the person of the architect is and what the relevance of architectural design is for the 21st century. And I think that agenda must address some major issues impacting the built environment, healthy cities in the global south and north, place, quality and community, regeneration, design practice, energy and technological innovation. And I think a school of architecture should be a place for innovative practice in its widest sense. And I think its location should be chosen to try and collaborate with as many studio-based disciplines as possible. The destination should be the gateway to an innovative and creative profession. So I want us to develop further our unique, as David says, holistic way of working, which is crucial to identify and resolve and address these growing environmental issues. Finally, I want the school, e-school, to be actively seeking to influence four key areas: the construction industry, which is research and skills bereft almost, the architectural profession, which often speaks to itself and not to others, the makers and procurers, who are often the employers of contemporary architects, and the general public, to break down barriers of elitism and taste. Thank you.
And next I would like to ask Lucy Morey.
The question, what is the purpose of architecture education, is really a response, I feel, to the fact that schools of architecture are failing to prepare students to practice as architects. This is not to say that schools of architecture are failing all students, because not all architecture students want to become architects. However, there is a problem when architectural practices cannot recruit competent staff, and there is a problem when newly qualified architects do not have all the skills to deliver a construction project or run their own practice. I have always believed that architecture is an excellent general undergraduate degree, in the same way as law, you can study law and not become a lawyer, or economics or engineering. Many people in business and doing other activities have those undergraduate degrees. And a degree in architecture teaches a range of creative, technical, and communication skills which are transferable and valuable to many careers. Therefore, I believe there is a case for separating the vocational and professional qualifications from the courses taught in higher education establishments. So in terms of the question, I think there are two purposes of architectural education today. One is a general education, and the second, professional.
So we'd like to open the question to the floor. Are there questions from anybody in the audience who'd like to speak to the Paris? A question to the panel?
I'm interested in the relationship between the governing body of architectural education in the EU and in the UK, the RIBA, and how those decisions are made and how possibly one might trump the other and how there might not be an equal marriage between the two. Would anybody like to comment on that?
It's almost inevitable that it actually will produce uneven results, because when the Revised Qualifications Directive was passed by the European Parliament last October, they've actually adopted two possible frameworks for the delivery of a minimum framework in architectural education. One is 4 years full-time study with 2 years of practical training, and the other is the 5+0, where the zero might be more than zero, but it's 5 years full-time study with no practical training. Just to put this in context, and without wishing to say five and four too many times, the current minimum standard across the EU is actually for 4 years full-time study only. In point of fact, there are very few countries who really do this. Denmark, the Netherlands, and Greece nominally all adopt this minimal framework. But you can see it differs significantly from what we're used to in the UK, where we've long recognised the proper synergies that should result from professional practice and architectural education. I think the time now actually is to make sure that we in the UK adopt a robust model. In terms of how that's generated, the RIBA is in an odd place. We're simply a charter body. You know, a monarch of this country decided at one time that there would be a thing called the Royal Institute of British Architects, William IV, if I recall. And we've been around, I think, now for 180 years. So there's quite a lot of momentum behind being around for so long. Often when I walk around the building, I suspect it may be with the same personnel as it was in 1834. And I think there's a general perception that we're slow to move. But ultimately, we're not the authority about this. We're simply somebody who has an established relationship with schools of architecture, both in the UK and worldwide. It is the statutory body, the Architects Registration Board, who ultimately have to sanction a model for architecture education. So all I can say is that we're pushing what we believe is going to be a flexible and better value model, but ultimately we have to take the statutory body with us. And various insignificant bodies like the Department of Communities and Local Government, you know, the government body, who are ultimately responsible for architecture education. So the number of stakeholders, I hate the word, but I'll use it anyway, you know what I mean by that. The number of interested parties that we have to take with us include the schools, include the statutory body, include government departments, include all the future students of architecture. So the problem is a very complex problem and one that we have to solve quite quickly.
More questions, qualifications, and general education. I thought that was a rather profound statement.
Thanks. It was mentioned that the purpose of an architectural education is to prepare for practice as an architect. In order to practice as an architect, you need to first practice as an architect's assistant. And I think the skills required are maybe slightly different. And I wonder if anybody on the panel feels that architecture schools adequately prepare people for practice as an architect's assistant in terms of the basic skills required to act in that role.
Do you know what?
Into the microphone, please, sir.
Don't worry. Entrepreneurs are outsiders. And I've just been listening to what was being saying and reflecting. And actually, at the end of the day, the issue of separation is really pointless if you don't have any work and you don't have any money coming in. And one of the things I was reflecting on this first question is you can't actually answer that, because architectural education is irrelevant unless you set it in the context of society and what's happening today. So a little quick point. I did history, which had all the attributes that you've just outlined from doing architecture, except in my day, there were no fees and I got a grant and it was fantastic. And it was a great subject to study. But we spent a lot of time justifying what you got out of history and where you were going to be. And I sat my first final in 1979, the day Margaret Thatcher came to power. We went into the building and she won the election and everybody kind of went, the wind has changed direction. A year later, it was virtually impossible for people to get jobs and teaching. The whole thing was in disarray. And we are now back at that situation just now. We are in a completely different world. And the real question is, why do you want to be an architect and what do you want to do after it? And you've got a choice. You can join the club and go and do the corporate work and take the shilling, or you can do something different. But if you want to do something different, you have to recognise that you're going to have to be entrepreneurial about that, and you're going to have to think differently and do different things. And there's also one final point. My course was paid for, and I got a grant. It's a bloody expensive course now to have the luxury to say at the end, oh, well, you can maybe have transferable skills. That's not really on, and it's also a highly competitive market. So what I'm really going to say is, Are you going to change the world? Because entrepreneurs do want to change the world. And if so, you're going to have to start thinking about it and how you do that and how you deal with people and how you bring architecture back into society.
Thank you. Actually, based on what you just said about history and what you've said about transferable skills and all of this, I'm curious as to your views on the role of history and theory in the future of architectural education. Is there a role for it, and what should that be?
I can maybe add something to that. I'm in a really lucky position where I work in an office which I'm surrounded with architects who are specialists in conservation, restoration, and such like. So for me, it's vital to understand how things used to be built and understand the fundamentals about that in order to design something of quality today that's going to last. I mean, I think the average life expectancy of a house is something like 50 years or something like that. And for me, that's just incredible, because we should be designing things that are going to last 200 years rather than 20 years. I've learned so much from being in that environment, which I don't think when I was at university I imagined I was going to be in, because everybody thinks, oh, well, I like contemporary design, so that's all I'm going to do. But understanding that those fundamentals and the fact that you see building, I've always lived in a house that's been hundreds of years old, just because I'm more comfortable there and I like that lifestyle and the way that building feels and the quality, and I may have to repair it more often, but I know it's going to last me longer. So for me, it's that historical aspect is fundamental.
I certainly think history should still be taught in architecture schools, but I think there are many other subjects that should be taught. If you think about the role of the architect who's actually designing and delivering buildings in the current society, the process of procuring, delivering buildings has changed enormously. And if you're thinking about the kind of clients, the professional clients, the developers, investors, or contractors, or local authorities who are commissioning buildings, who are employing architects, in fact, they're not employing the architect first. They often engage a quantity surveyor, a project manager, a letting agent, or a surveyor before the architect. And architects are often seen as expensive and out of touch with reality. And they're brought in because they need to get through planning. There's a tricky planning site. They're going to need something a bit clever, something beautiful. And the architects may create a beautiful image, but it may be too expensive. And unfortunately, many architects do not understand the economics of property development and investment. So I'd like to see an architectural education encompassing cost analysis, project management, finance, business, engineering, the industrialization of producing elements, BIM, maintenance, energy efficiency. It's a huge subject and probably too much, and specialization will be necessary. And I would take the lead from some other professional education where you have core subjects and electives that enable students to specialize in the bits that they're interested in. So out of your architectural education, you may be a more historical, traditional conservation design architect, or you may be a more project management architect who has a good understanding of the financing of development projects and can do the cost analysis and can make good decisions up front for the client. Because if you look back over time, the architect traditionally had the leadership role on a construction project, and that has been lost. And I really think there is an opportunity in these changes to architectural education for the architect to reclaim that leadership. But the way in doing that is really having to understand what is needed in order to design and deliver a building in today and in the future.
Thanks. Several people have kind of talked about this idea of it being vocational. So say I went and did not architecture, I was a dentist or a doctor, I'd come out 5 years and that's what I would do. I would go and be, I would leave university being able to be a dentist or be a doctor. Do you see architecture as vocational in terms of it gets you the job of an architect, or it gets you a job, kind of, when you talk about it being vocational?
I'll say something because I've not said anything yet. I think that's a really important and valued question. When we start education, whether it's architecture or becoming a dentist, I don't think we're fully sure what we've committed ourselves to. So I think any educational process should prepare ourselves for life after that, whether that is becoming a dentist or becoming an architect. When it comes to architecture, though, and I don't know much about the dentist profession, so maybe I'm wrong here, but when it comes to architecture, I think it's such a wide variety of skills that are required that go beyond that line on the drawing. It goes, you need to be able to communicate, you need to be able to be vocal about it, you need to have an opinion, you need to be able to design. But I think the most important thing is to understand what you want to do is to provide a sustainable environment eventually. And that means you need to understand the brief, you need to understand the people that use it. So understanding social skills, understanding the human psychology, all that should also be part of architectural education. And I don't think we can go back to the traditional role of the architect where the architect is leading, because there's so many other consultancies that all represent the original role of the architect at the time. We cannot oversee all those elements in a delivery process anymore, like construction engineering, like a quantity surveyor. In the old days, it was the architect that did that. We cannot do all that anymore ourselves. But we have to be aware of them. We have to be confident in dealing with them in a delivery process, and all that should be touched upon during education. And whether that makes you a good architect in the end, or potentially a good developer, maybe. Why not? Become a developer after studying architect. I think that would be fantastic. So I don't know whether that answers your question, but I do think the architectural profession is so widely defined. We should be prepared for that as students, but we should also should feel confident when we graduate.
Can I just jump in before you, Chris? I think the thing is that you get taught how to design, and you can apply that process of design and making something to quite a lot of different things. So the skills to design a building in some ways aren't that much different to designing a product. You're still going through the same reiterative process. So I don't think just because you do architecture, you have to then be an architect. And I think in some cases now, students have had to think, well, I've done this 5 to 7 year architectural education and there isn't a job for me, so they've been forced to look elsewhere.
I'd quite like to get away from this idea, implicit in some of these comments, that the purpose of a school of architecture is somehow to train for the profession. It's not. I'm of the view very much that town and gown should come closer together, but I'm not in favour of the school training for what you're going to do in the profession, because you can look back through history and see that, you know, the discipline of architecture, even though the profession is very young, the topic creates a whole series of different models. The Parthenon, Hillhead Primary School, my house, you could all describe perhaps as architectural. So the discipline doesn't really change that much throughout history. What changes is all of the external influences on it. That's where schools of architecture have to be nimble, agile, aware. They're not necessarily there to cover all of the ground in this vastly changing profession, because it changes all the time. In my experience, a lot of the things that are being raised here are things that you can't really learn properly until you're in practice. It presumes that we just learn here, and somehow when you're in practice, you're just doing it and you're not learning it. Well, it's very much the opposite. There's huge leaps. I remember very vividly, and I left school, went straight into an architect's office for 4 years before coming in as a full-time student here. So I deliberately didn't want to be a student, still actually don't, deliberately wanted to be somebody who was working, who was doing it. I saw it as something practical. And it was only later that I realized the real luxury and the pleasure of studying it. But it was something that I studied that I had already started to do. So all of these new, and even in the last 10 years, the new roles, the new specialisms, the new players in the industry, the new responsibilities and leaderships, and the changing role of the architect, these are all things that the architect has to address. But they don't necessarily change the values or the qualities, because at the end of the day, as I say, there are people who have to set what I would call an architectural destination, who lead by the vision, and I don't mean that in a romantic way, not because they're contractually the leader, but the meeting doesn't take the meeting doesn't really get going until the architect's there, regardless of whether the project manager or the client or the contractor is actually the employer. That's what we're trying to help you guys take with you, this versatility, this range of skills to be adaptable in this changing circumstance. If you don't have an idea of why you're doing it, there's no point in coming up with all these skills and changing roles and whatever you want to call it. You need to know why you're doing it. The other thing I want to just say before I pass on to Chris, I think I wanted to say something, is that it's very difficult to know what you want to do when you are choosing your subjects at school, regardless of whether you're an architect or a doctor or whatever. So you quite often find something more or a clarity about these things only when you've already made that commitment. And in my case, well after I became an architect in practice. So I wouldn't be in a rush or in, you're particularly anxious to think you've got to gather all this stuff in your haversack before you go into practice. You don't. You need to be ready to learn. And for me, that meant a five-year learning process after my part three. And that was me already with 4 years under the belt. So it's an attitude more than a particular set of skills. Mm-hmm. Sorry, I'm hogging.
No. Hanneke just, I thought, made a really exciting suggestion. Be a developer. Entrepreneurs cannot do anything until they visualize. They've got to, and it takes a while to visualize. And they love a bit of chaos and a bit of anarchy, because that's the fun, and changing the rules and going, oh, why is that done that way? We could do this. And it is actually quite interesting, because when you actually say become a developer, it means that you can use your architectural skills and learning and apply it in practice in ways that actually fit what you would like to see happening. But you learn to be an entrepreneur by doing. It's not something that's taught, it's not born, it's not made, it's by doing. And the three key things are, first of all, you learn how to negotiate your resources. And that really is quite an interesting one, because your ability to interact with clients and people and confer and discuss and take people with you is vital. The next thing is you learn by doing, which I've said. And the third thing is you do that by a can-do attitude. And it's people going, well, that's rubbish, and learning how to overcome that. But in Woodlands, in the corner, in a derelict, I think it was a former bomb site, there's a new development that's going up. It's the decaying area, fascinating, walk past it. It's a corner site, and they're putting in artist studios. It's not bricks, it's not cement, it's wooden sheds. And I walked past that, and it's next to the community garden. And there is this set of really interesting wooden sheds for artist studios. And it gave me such a kick to see that. And I think it must have given the architectural practice that's designed that such a kick to do that. But it's highly entrepreneurial. It's low cost, it's cheap, you can see it and it can emerge. It's not big, it's not grand, but it's a start. And that's how you learn by doing. And that's the kind of thing that really has to start coming across, having a shot at something and learning how it goes.
I'm going to have to preclude the discussion and go on to the next question. So the second question is, how can architecture students be educated in a more flexible and economic means for them, for the actual students? And the first person I'd like to answer that question is Mr. Scott.
Actually, I'm really interested in comments. I mean, I don't know if architects can ever be entrepreneurs. Name an entrepreneur that was an architect. Any takers from the...
Andy Barlow.
Thank you very much. We don't see them on the Apprentice, sorry.
Frank Gehry was quite entrepreneurial when he started off.
I would put him down as a highly successful businessman who makes a lot of money. I'm not quite sure that that's the same as entrepreneurship.
There are risks in the way he's developed his practice. He's done it in a non-conventional way.
Which brings us to, what do you want out of this whole thing? And actually, one of the things people talked about was a job. Actually, are there jobs out there? And if you want that job, you're going to have to do something. An ex-architect friend of mine who now makes jewellery said, oh, I left. She said, it's either run by psychopaths and you're a cad monkey in front of them, or there's this. I thought, well, that's pushing it, Anne. But she was actually making a point. That's why she wanted out of it. She didn't want to be part of that. She wanted to do something different. She's using all of her architectural skills now in making jewellery. And actually, it's not the making, it's the designing, and she'll take it on to the next level. I think what's coming out here is that has to be through something which is a bit nimble, flexible, learning by doing and having a shot at things. And actually, can you offer your services as a student free of charge to people who want to do something?
You can offer them for money as well.
You can offer them for the money as well, and that's you already moving into... I mean, actually, that is an interesting point. If on that basis you say, we'll help you do all of this, legally, what does that actually mean? Are there implications from...
You don't need to call yourself an architect to practice architecture. It's just a title that's protected. Whether you get commissions in architecture is another question. But you don't need to be qualified. You don't need to come through an architectural school. And from the point of view of students working, I'm not quite sure if your question is about working with an architect or just working generally.
Working generally.
Oh, there's no limits to what students can do, as far as I'm concerned.
Well, that was a tag team answer to the question, which I think cleverly avoided.
No, I'll answer the question.
Oh, well, sorry, you'll have to wait till the comments. I'd like to ask Stuart Falconer to answer. How can architecture students be educated in a more flexible manner and a more economic manner for students?
How can they be educated in a more economic manner?
Flexible.
Well, I think one of the examples is across the road now, actually. That's the first time I've seen that building. And actually, one of the important things for me is that multi-sort of disciplinary side to it, because I think maybe sometimes, certainly in my education, we were in an architecture building and you did architecture and you didn't really want to talk to anyone else. And I think there's a real merit in speaking to other people, working with other people, understanding what skills they have, how you might apply them, how you can work together. Collaborating, I think, is one of the most important things. And the building across the road, for me, just the first time I've seen it today, certainly internally, you're walking around and you can see somebody doing something you might otherwise never have seen. So for me, that is a really, really important aspect of being able to be more flexible, because it opens your eyes up to seeing to other things. If you work for yourself all the time, I think you're just limited in what your own capabilities are. As soon as there's somebody else in the room with a different attitude, it opens up multiple possibilities.
I guess I'm sort of stepping outside my role as the chairman here, just to try to clarify the question. I think what the students are wondering is, are there other modes of education, such as, you know, part-time? We at the school have a part-time mode, and I think we're one of the only schools in Scotland. I think there's a couple of schools in the rest of the UK. But are there other ways that the model of education could be more flexible and not quite so expensive for students? I think that was the gist of the question. I'll ask the organizers to confirm that.
Look, I mean,
we're going to have a little 5-minute aside. It's not in the agenda, but we'll let David Gloucester answer that question, because he's involved intimately in that process.
The fact is that the UK, of course, does architecture education exceptionally well. I can say that from first-hand observation of architecture education delivered globally, whether it's Latin America, the Middle East, the Far East, Russian Federation. We do it very, very well. And the first thing we need to reassure ourselves is that we actually have a pretty good model here. The big problem is that model is subject to political pressures, which we couldn't have anticipated. And Ian's points about being paid to be a student, as indeed I was, not very much. And I spent most of my grant on an electric guitar, which I've never regretted either. but the important thing is the circumstances under which you're studying, the circumstances under which we studied are hugely different, and the circumstances in which you practice your craft. But the question about responsiveness and more economic models, of course there can be. I mean, it's absurd, really, to suggest that you shouldn't be able to draw down an electronic learning module at 3 a.m. in the morning after you've just got back off a hard day's, half day's work in the practice that's sustaining you, or the bar that you're working as a bartender in. Of course, you should be able to study and have access to information and access to your learning 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I think the construct of sitting in a room like this is absolutely great. And, you know, the reason one comes to events like this is to get this kind of intimacy of exchange between people. But the reality is that we all gather information, not knowledge. We may need to distinguish between information and knowledge. We've actually got too much information, not enough knowledge. And the classroom probably provides the filter between these things. I think we would certainly like to see entirely different models for learning. The RIBA office-based exam, for example, is a distance learning scheme where, in some cases, the online tutors never ever meet the candidates who they're tutoring. It's been running for 10 years now. It has something like 250 candidates registered on it. And that's just one example. Part-time study is obviously another one. But I think the idea of a peripatetic student of architecture who's not necessarily registered at any one university, but simply acts like a kind of guerrilla, taking academic modules from a network of schools, which might be global, not even national, is the kind of model that we have to look at in the future. We can't kid ourselves that we have a monopoly on knowledge in the UK, or that we have a monopoly on the means to deliver it through what has actually become, I would argue, a pretty inflexible system for architectural education. Yes, it can be done more cheaply. I think there's a way of being able to identify very, very self-critically the fact that there is quite a lot in the architecture curriculum which is sacrificial. We need to be very, very careful now. With students paying £9,000 a year, you aren't exposed to something that is incredibly entertaining but essentially sacrificial. The course needs to be stripped down to its basics. And I certainly don't discount the issues that Lucy's talking about business skills. Indeed, I think that it's fundamental that the part three elements, the professional skills elements, need to make everybody understand that whether we like it or not, we're working to and responding to a commercial context. But we need to be super analytical. And the lead has to come from the schools. The RIBA can only provide a kind of sketch in the air of what these models will become. But ultimately, the schools have to be prepared to stage their own coup d'etats internally to actually provide models which are fit for the 22nd, let alone the 21st century.
I just would like to ask Hanneke to answer or respond to the question.
First of all, education costs money. Tutors cost money, a building costs money. There's many aspects. Education costs money, and you just have to accept that. I'm still paying for my education, and I graduated 16 years ago. And I think it's important that you... I know that sounds horrible. But it's been worth every penny. I had a fantastic time as a student, and it has really equipped me to a really happy life I'm leading just now. It's been worth every penny. And this is how you should see it. You should invest in yourself, and it costs money. To my surprise, as a Dutch person coming to Scotland, I found that a lot of students actually don't work next to their study. I've been teaching at and tutoring here for a couple of years now, and it seems more an exception than the rule that students work. And I know architectural course takes a lot of your time, but